Thank you for having me here for Hispanic Heritage Month. I am Samantha Bomkamp, the Collections Manager at the Blackwater Draw Museum. I've been with Eastern New Mexico for about a year now. I arrived in November 2020, so it was kind of a weird year to arrive. As we all know, we're finally able to do these talks again, which is great. I graduated with my Master's in Anthropology and Museum Studies from UW-Milwaukee in May of 2020. So I'm excited to talk about my master's thesis research with you today, and then a trip that I took to Chihuahua, Mexico in 2019. Before I start, I wanted to acknowledge that we at ENMU are here today on the homeland of several Native tribes, including the Kiowa, the Comanche, and the Mescalero Apache. I encourage everyone to learn about the land that we live on and study. So we're going to do a little bit of traveling together today. We will start in Chihuahua, Mexico, as I introduce the Casas Grandes region, and then fly north to Wisconsin, where I'll dive into the research from a collection that I worked on at the Milwaukee Public Museum. We'll then head back to Chihuahua, where I'll highlight the trip I took in 2019 and my related research. Then we'll head back here to ENMU, where I'll briefly discuss the Casas Grandes collection that we have at our very own Blackwater Draw Museum. So the Casas Grandes culture existed mostly in what is present-day Chihuahua, Mexico. But archaeological evidence expands into Arizona, New Mexico, and Texas. The Casas Grandes culture is closely related to the American Southwest. However, many people have never heard of it because it's located across the modern border in Mexico. The Casas Grandes culture also has ties to Mesoamerica and influences such as ball quartz found at the site throughout the region, a topic I'll talk on later. If you look at the Google map here, you'll see the location of the largest site in the Casas Grandes region, which is known by two names, Casas Grandes and Pakime. For this presentation and in my thesis, I've used Pakime to refer to this site. The background image that I've used for this PowerPoint is also an aerial view of Pakime. Dates for the region are presently debated by archaeologists, but for the intention of my research and the pottery I worked with, I was interested in two time periods, the Viejo and the Medio. The Viejo period is characteristic of pit house type structures and pre-ceramic or pre-polychrome pottery. The Medio period is when pottery production really boomed and polychromes were introduced. This is the time period that gets the most attention in the region. Therefore, compared to sites now located in the U.S., the height of the Casas Grandes society happens after many of the areas in the American Southwest had been depopulated. Some of you might be familiar with some of these sites, such as Chaco Canyon and Mesa Verde. The earliest written records were recorded by the Spaniards from the 1500s. It's possible that Pakime was the first site described by Europeans in northwest Mexico and the southwestern United States in 1584, but some archaeologists believe it was described even earlier during the expedition of Francisco de Ibarra and Baltasar Obregón in the 1560s. Which is only 100 years after the depopulation of the site. The Spaniards observed 6 to 7 story structures, towers, patios, and beautifully painted houses. Alfred Kidder, a famous southwestern archaeologist, visited the Casas Grandes region in 1916 and established one of the earliest pottery classifications for the culture. The largest and arguably most important research done at Pakime came in the 1960s, during the Joint Casas Grandes Expedition, or the JCGE, which was led by Charles de Peso, pictured here. This expedition was a partnership between the Ameren Foundation of Arizona and ENA, the Institute of National Archaeology and History in Mexico. The results of the JCGE were published in an 8-volume series in 1974 and were a great resource in my thesis research. Today, two of the most influential archaeologists of the Casas Grandes region are Michael Whalen and Paul Minnis. Their archaeological work in the 1990s surveyed over 300 Casas Grandes sites beyond Pakime and provided a much larger picture of the periphery of the region. It is important to remember throughout this presentation that although the Casas Grandes is located in present-day Mexico, it is generally regarded as part of the southwestern cultural family, but has been severely understudied in comparison to those located across the U.S. border. Additionally, there is no modern tribe that claims the Casas Grandes culture, unlike what we are familiar with here in New Mexico. This makes learning through archaeological methods extremely important, while also challenging. Charles de Peso was the leading archaeologist for the the JCGE excavations in the 1960s and the 8-volume publications that followed after in 1974. His name is also synonymous with this site at this, to this day. Hockey Bay was awarded as a UNESCO World Heritage Site in 1998 and includes a museum run by ENMU. The site is extremely unique for a variety of reasons that we'll see throughout this presentation, but some of them include the presence of Mesoamerican style bottle carts, turkey and macaw breeding pens, and platform mounds. Excavations revealed thousands of trade goods such as turquoise, marine shell, and copper artifacts. So now let's head north to Wisconsin. The Milwaukee Public Museum is located in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and opened to the public in 1884. It curates collections from all over the world, including halls dedicated to dinosaurs, the Ice Age, Africa, South America, and tribes from North America. While MPM's exhibits cover cultures throughout Mesoamerica and the Southwest, no exhibit currently exists that discusses the Casas Grandes culture. My hope is that following my thesis research, an exhibit will be possible. The MPM has had a long partnership with the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee and the Museum Studies Program, which is how I ended up doing a thesis on one of their collections. If any of you find yourself in Wisconsin soon, I highly recommend that you check out this museum. So some of you might be wondering how a Southwest collection of this size ended up all the way in Wisconsin, just a tad far from Mexico. Well, most of the collection was donated by one man, Peter Ray, in the 1970s. Mr. Ray lived in Phoenix, Arizona, and collected pre-Columbian art during the 1960s and 70s. The Casas Grandes materials included 80 vessels with a mixture of utilitarian and non-utilitarian wares. The collection had very little provenance information, which means that we don't have any contextual data, and most were only documented as from the Casas Grandes region. This was one of the main challenges of my research. My thesis covered several research goals, including those listed here. Many of these goals came from my museum collections background. However, they also included archaeological questions, such as how this private collection compares to archaeological data from the region. These research goals include: how many Chihuahuan pottery types are present in the MPM's collection? What kind of design elements are present? And how do the types and iconography in the MPM collection compared to other Casas Grandes pottery collections or excavation results? We will be focusing primarily on the first two during this presentation today. This collection is extremely important because it's the largest known collection of Casas Grandes ceramics at a public institution in Wisconsin. Before my thesis research, very little work had been done with the collection and very little was known. Bringing awareness and background to this collection is one of the greatest rewards after the publication of my thesis. My hope is now that the collection can be used for future exhibition, programming, and research. I also believe that it is essential to state how important archaeological collections without provenience can be. These collections are often overlooked. This was one of the most important aspects I wanted to prove with this research. We can still learn so much from unprovenience collections. And needing to address the question of how the MPM's collection compares to similar questions, I set out in the summer of 2018, while in the Southwest, for an internship, to research at a handful of museums. I visited four collections total: the Ameren Foundation in Dragoon, Arizona, which holds the largest collection of Casas Grandes pottery in the U.S., the El Paso Museum of Archaeology, the Museum of Northern Arizona in Flagstaff, and the Museum of Indian Arts and Culture in Santa Fe. At each museum, I selected a small sample of vessels to analyze that would provide complementary information to those I was using at the MPM. These collections provided a larger variety of motif styles, such as macaw variations and effigies of animals not present in my thesis collection. It also allowed me to present comparisons in the similarities of design styles or representations. The photos on the screen here show a snake effigy vessel from the MPM and a very similar one from the El Paso Museum of Archaeology. The ceramic analysis I used in my methodology included creating a coding scheme in Microsoft Excel. The attributes that I recorded for each pot are listed at the bottom of the screen here. Based on these attributes, I was able to type each of the vessels. Typing pottery is a way that archaeologists are able to classify and organize artifacts from different cultures, as you can see on the table on the right here. This system is not something peoples of the past used, but something researchers utilize for uniformity today. When talking about Casas Grandes pottery specifically, some of the attributes that set types apart include painted versus unpainted, bichromes versus polychromes, or whether the paints touch inside the designs or not. Once each pot was typed, it was able to be dated within a time period based on current understandings of which types were produced when. For example, many of the unpainted or bichromes in the collection came from the earlier of the Ho period. However, sometimes some types, especially those that are utility wares and didn't change much over time, were unable to be dated to one single time period and were instead given a range. This is as specific as we can be when utilizing artifacts without contextual data. And this is also why it's so important not to disturb archaeological sites. De Peso's 8-volume series included a lot of information on types from the Casas Grandes region. And this was very helpful when typing each of the pots from the Milwaukee Public Museum. An example of De Peso and colleagues' classification can be seen here on the screen. However, these volumes were published in the 1970s, and since then, archaeologists have learned more about the region. I had to update and compare this with modern data. This slide includes a few examples of the different types represented in the collection. The two on the right, Playas Red and Ramos Blanc, are two of the most common utility wares in this collection and in the region as a whole. Chihuahuan pottery is often most famous for its polychrome wares, including the three on the left, Ramos, Villa Amada, and Babica. And I can tell you that I took two semesters of ceramics classes here at ENMU, and I don't think that I would be able to ever make something this nice looking, nonetheless even attempt the precise painted woodwork. These were highly skilled potters, to say the least. The second component to my thesis was a design analysis. As I mentioned, painted wares are what a lot of people think of when they think of Chihuahuan pottery. The bichromes and polychromes are known for being highly geometric and including repeating patterns. Those of you that are familiar with pottery from the American Southwest may notice some similarities here. My analysis of the iconography on the polychrome pottery included three main components: layout, motifs, and effigies. I used a second coding scheme for this process and recorded attributes on each vessel to tally how many were represented in the collection. I primarily used the attributes that De Peso and his colleagues recorded in their 1974 volumes, and a thesis published by Mitch Hendrickson in 2000. The layout analysis was subdivided into three categories: primary, secondary, and overall. So without getting into excruciating detail here, I will say that layout is essentially the design around the exterior of a jar or effigy that repeats. Casas Grandes pottery in general is known for having repeating designs. Oftentimes, the layout repeats into four quadrants around the exterior of the vessel. Take this jar on the screen as an example. These four images show the vessel rotated to show all four sides. We can see how two primary designs are repeated around the vessel. We can also see how precisely and evenly the vessels were planned and executed. I only recorded and used the layout types present in the MPM's collection. This included seven primary layouts, five secondary layouts, and two overall layouts, as seen here. Secondary layout is quite similar to the primary layout and was not as frequently occurring, but the overall layout refers to the interior designs and bowls. The collection included three bowls with painted interiors and utilized two different overall layouts. Motifs are design elements found within layouts that represent an idea or object. The most popular example of this is the macaw as shown on the bowl in the lower left. I will elaborate more on macaws later, but it's important to know that, like other Southwestern cultures, macaws are highly important birds imported from Mesoamerica. Their brightly colored feathers colors were sought after and used in rituals throughout both regions. Eight motifs were identified on the vessels from the MPM's collection, as seen on the screen here. My results were extremely similar to those identified by other researchers, including Henry Carey, who was one of the first to conduct a Casas Grandes design analysis in 1931. The last category of the design analysis was effigies. I divided effigies into three categories: one, appliqué effigies; two, hooded effigies; and three, true effigies. Example of each of these can be seen on the screen. These classifications are similar to those used by DePaso in the 1960s and 70s, as well as Alfred Kitter much earlier in 1960. The MPM collection had 20 effigies total. These vessels often provide greater insights than bowls or jars. So for example, sometimes the animal forms can be identified down to the species or at least the genus level. One such vessel in the MPM collection likely represents a Montezuma quail. So what were the final results of my research? The MPM collection has 15 different Casas Grandes ceramic types, which are all listed on the table here. Two time periods are represented in the collection, with the majority from the medieval period. There were also a total of 68 jars and 12 bowls. Private collections provide a skewed view of some of these tallies as collectors introduce a bias into the sample. With polychrome pottery, this often means polychromes are favored. The design analysis yielded interesting results as well. Patterns revealed themselves suggesting that certain layouts were favored for certain types. For example, panel layouts were the most commonly occurring primary layout, and 80% of them were found in Ramos polychrome types. This fact was not surprising, considering Ramos polychrome was often the most commonly occurring of the painted wares. These trends were similar to those found in other research conducted on museum collections from both private and archaeological contexts. The motifs recorded in the collection were quite abundant. One of the motifs that I wanted to get back to is the macaw. As mentioned, the macaw was an extremely important bird to the Casas Grandes people. Just like at Chaco Canyon, macaw skeletons were excavated at Pakime. Unlike at Chaco Canyon, Pakime had macaw pens and birds which were bred at the site. The macaw is exhibited in a variety of ways on the pottery, including painted or appliqué to the exterior. So appliqué essentially means that it's an appendage or something attached, like here. And then obviously the painted designs come in all different forms. So these are all different variations of the macaw. The effigies in the collection represented a variety of human and animal forms. There were 11 human effigies and 9 animals total. The animals included birds, snakes, and unidentified animals, such as one that I suggest might be a badger. By the end of my thesis research, I was successfully able to answer my initial questions, including how many Chihuahuan types are present and what design elements are represented in this collection. I am proud about how much data I uncovered with a previously unresearched collection, and I believe it is now in a good stage to be used for further research or programming. My concluding chapter suggests a few avenues for future research, including comparisons that could be made between Roncar and Chihuahua and ceramic art. This is a perfect transition to the education trip I took to Chihuahua, Mexico in 2019. I accompanied the Crow Canyon Archaeological Center in November. Upon visiting one of the sites, we used a scope to look into a cave across the river. You can see in the photo I took with my phone through the scope on the bottom right here. Upon returning, I found an illustration of rock art from the Casas Grandes region by Carl Lumholtz in his book Unknown Mexico from 1902. I thought it looked oddly familiar, so I went back to my photos from the trip and found that I had been looking inside the same cave from his illustration. The education seminar was called Meridian Migrations. The opportunity presented itself perfectly in the middle of my graduate school career, and I jumped at the opportunity to fundraise and go. The two scholars that led the program were Dr. Steve Lechson on the left and Dr. Mike Mathiowitz on the right. We also had other archaeologists on the trip, including Mark Varian from Pearl Canyon and Kathy Cameron We have the pleasure of being accompanied by Mexican archaeologist Eduardo Gamboa, who is the director of the museum at Pakime. Eduardo added an insider perspective to the sites that we never would have had without him. This trip allowed us to visit archaeological sites in the Casas Grandes region, including the primary site of Pakime, as well as several cliff-dwelling sites throughout the region. These locations will make more sense in a minute, but for now I've underlined the three primary locations to give you an idea of where we were traveling. Several of these sites are difficult to get to without an experienced and knowledgeable guide. Pakime was our first stop once we made the drive over from Ciudad Chihuahua. The museum on site, called the Museo de las Culturas del Norte, holds the largest collection of archaeologically recovered Casas Grandes materials. The Institute of National Archaeology and History, ENA, operates the site and museum. The museum holds an amazing amount of artifacts excavated from the site, including a huge column filled with marine shell, which is a great visual representation of how many trade goods were coming into this center. As I mentioned earlier, Pakime is unique because it has influences from both the American Southwest and Mesoamerica. Influences from the north include adobe structures, T-shaped doorways, and geometric painted pottery. Influences from what is now Mexico include rock architecture such as ball courts and mounds. It also has turkey and macaw pens and agave roasting pits. Excavation data from the site suggests in its heyday, Pakime may have had as many as 2,000 rooms. Pakime, as well as other sites throughout the Casas Grandes region, also exhibit T-shaped doors. Some of you may recognize these from Chaco Canyon or the Mesa Verde region. These doors are another argument for the ties to American Southwest cultures. Dr. Steve Lexon, one of the scholars accompanying us on the trip, has written a lot about T-doors and their possible cultural meaning in the region, a topic hotly debated among archaeologists. This slide shows one of the large agave roasting pits in the bottom left corner. The photo on the top left is the mound of the offerings. Inside, archaeologists found large polychrome pots with cremated human remains, suggesting the importance of the individuals found within. The photo in the middle is our group standing on one of the large platform mounds, which is believed to be in the shape of a bird. The site also includes a long serpent mound. And of course, in the upper right is a unique effigy pot of a human laying on their side with a bird painted on their chest. Eduardo informed us that his team is doing ongoing excavations and restoration work at the site. In 2019, they had uncovered wooden beams that were good candidates for tree ring dating. Our first cliff-dwelling site, Cueva de la Hoya, took us up into the Sierra Madres. It gets its name from the large granary in the bottom right photo here, which looks like an upside-down olla or jar. These granaries, which held stocks of food, often corn, were common for us to see in the cliff-dwelling sites. However, this was by far the most preserved one we would see. This site was the easiest to get to both by car and hiking, and the sites would only get harder to get to as our trip went on. The bottom left photo shows some of the remaining walls of the structure inside the cave. You'll notice another iconic T-shaped door. Unfortunately, because this site is so accessible, a lot of the walls have been knocked over or vandalized. After Cueva de la Hoya, we followed the stream to a few smaller cliff-dwelling sites, including the one with the rock art I showed in the first slide. Cueva de las Ventanas, or Cave of the Windows, is a well-preserved site that we squeezed into a busy day. The trail required us to hike down into the canyon and then up the other side at around 7,000 feet elevation, but it was well worth the trip. Many beams are original and still intact. Paint can also be seen on the walls if you look closely. This site has had much more restoration done on it than some of the other dwellings we saw, including many supporting beams holding up the second story. It is part of a larger grouping of cliff-dwelling sites that ENA manages called 40 Casas. Cueva de la Serpiente, or Cave of the Serpent, was one of the most interesting sites to get to. It required us to squeeze down a narrow path. path between large boulders and scale down steps while hanging onto a rope, as you can see Dr. Lexon doing here in the photo. The cave got its name from a painted snake that was found over a T-shaped door frame, circled in red here. Although it's hard to make out today, you can still see green and blue paint residue. This site was particularly interesting because the adobe structure sits inside an opening on the mountain to which one can walk from one side to the other. So if you're afraid of heights, I don't suggest going this way. The structure was fairly small and estimated to have 14 rooms. Following Cueva de la Serpiente, we hiked to an outlook where we could see down into another dwelling named Cueva del Mirador. This site is particularly inaccessible to those unwilling to rock climb, and included two partially preserved granaries and several painted walls reminiscent of geometric designs on the pottery, which you can kind of see next to this beam here. There's a few triangles. We also visited an atalaya, which is an overlook area used for communicating across large distances. Similar types of technology were used in prehistoric cultures throughout the world. Archaeologists debate whether the ones in Chihuahua used fire or not to send signals. Although the least original of the names, Cueva Grande was extremely beautiful. The cave is hidden in a surprisingly lush area, fed by the waterfall that streams from the top of the cave and falls in front of the dwellings. As you can see from the photos, several structures still stand two stories tall and include original organic building materials. This site also included the remains of a granary. The back of the cave would have certainly been a reprieve from the heat in the summer. Cueva Grande, Cueva de la Serpiente, and Cueva del Mirador are all part of a larger Huapoca complex, which reportedly has over 180 archaeological sites. Cueva de la Rancheria was the last site we visited and unique for many reasons, the first being that it was most difficult to get to. First, we drove as far as we could in our large passenger vans. Then we took turns riding jeeps up a steep and narrow road, 2 kilometers to our drop-off location near the river. From there, we hiked another 3.5 kilometers up the river, guided by our wonderful ENA archaeologist, Eduardo. We wove back and forth across the stream for about an hour before reaching the site. This also meant that a couple people in our trip weren't able to make it all the way up, who were a little bit older. The site itself stood out for a couple reasons. One, being it was so difficult to get to, it had been far less disturbed than other sites. This meant that there was much better preservation and material culture left in place. You can see the manos and matates that are still on site here in the top photo, top left. Other artifacts like pottery sherds and lithic debutas covered the ground. The site was still occupied when the Spanish arrived and continued to be after. Evidence of the Spaniards can be seen here. For example, it has a Spanish-style oven constructed during the occupation. We can see finger and handprints in the adobe from its construction in the upper right. It also has the remains of a granary seen in the center photo. The preservation of the art on the wall was also amazing. The far right photo shows original stucco and geometric black paint still visible below a T-door. Our guide, Eduardo, theorizes that whomever lived in this decorated room was of high status to the community. We packed lunches on this trip and enjoyed them near the site. After we returned to the river, where many of us enjoyed soaking our feet or heads to cool off from the long walk. One final component of our trip that I wanted to share was our visit to the town of Mato Ortiz. Mato Ortiz is located close to the prehistoric town of Paki. Some of you may have heard of it or seen the beautiful pottery that is made here and sold all over the Southwest. The pottery tradition of Mato Ortiz mainly started in the 1950s and 60s, when pottery was produced that was reminiscent of the Casas Grandes pottery tradition and often sold to tourists. However, as time went on, the Mato Ortiz tradition has taken on a culture of its own. Juan Posada, pictured on the left, is often known as the father of the Mato Ortiz tradition and is the most famous of the potters. We got to meet with him and he spoke with us about his methods. He sources all of his pigments and clay in Chihuahua and will often hike or horseback ride to find new sources and colors. And this is pretty impressive because I bet he was in his 70s. He and his family had several to hand process everything. He explained that it's often an experiment to see what color a pigment will fire, and it takes a lot of work to figure all of this out. He also sources his clay locally and took us outside to show how he processes the materials. I must say that I felt like I was meeting a celebrity that day and I had to get my pictures with Juan. He has pieces displayed in museums and art galleries all over the world, and his pots go for top dollar, as they should. They are remarkable works of craftsmanship and take an extraordinary amount of time to complete. Here are some examples of the Mata Ortiz pottery. The one on the left is a photo of one of the pots that I bought that's more of the traditional style, meaning that it emulates the Casas Grandes pottery. I wanted a contemporary pot that had a macaw image on it. You can see how this macaw is a little different than the prehistoric versions I showed you all earlier. I find it interesting how modern painters have taken artistic license in recreating a traditional style with a twist. I will also add that Mata Ortiz pottery is very affordable compared to other Southwestern contemporary pottery we might be familiar with. So next time some of you are in a gallery or museum gift shop, you may want to check some out. The pottery is so important in supporting the community and the people that live there. So to wrap up, I'll say that being able to take the trip to Chihuahua and visit the archaeological sites was an emotional experience. I was able to visit the place where the pottery I studied originated and glean insights into the people that made them. I learned so much from being able to go there and visit the dwellings, which I might add are places that very few people get to see these days. So finally we land back here at ENMU with the Blackwater Draw Museum collection. If you found this presentation interesting, I highly suggest you stop by the museum and see some of the pottery of the region for yourself. Our materials are from the Miles collection, which was obtained by ENMU in 1966. Our museum curates almost 3,000 archaeological and ethnographic objects from the collection, and the ENMU Natural History Museum creates the minerals. The collection includes over 260 artifacts from the Casas Grandes region, most of which are whole pots. This collection is several times larger than the one I did my thesis project on. I am eager to foster research with the collection, including assisting an ENMU graduate student that is conducting research on the materials as we speak. Currently, many pots can be seen on exhibit and display cases. We hope to launch a new exhibit on the pottery within the next year, which will provide visitors with greater insights into the culture, such as what you just learned from this presentation. So I hope you all enjoyed our little trip we took together today. I'm happy to take some questions.